Hello and welcome to RTC TV. My name is Jared Michael and I'm here with Chevy Teeter. We are in Death Valley getting ready for an exciting evening of high school football. It is October 7th and tonight's matchup is between the Tippecanoe Valley Vikings and the Wabash Apaches.
The Vikings are 2-5 and this so far this season and are probably looking for another win. After beating their big rivals Rochester last week, and a lot of that spirit has been put forth towards the game and practice this week, Valley has been looking forward to the return to old roots and running a newer style of offense and defense. So far, it has worked for them for the two consecutive wins under their new play style.
The Apaches 4-3 are in a bit of a rut right now, losing their last three games consecutively. Having said that, they both are looking to turn their fates around tonight in this game. Wabash so far this year has struggled with conference teams about as much as Valley. Common opponents have been Manchester, a win for both teams, and North Miami, a loss for both teams. Now, we're about ready to get ready as they prepare for kickoff. That'll be number 15, Eric Weber, a senior on that return.
So Wabash decked out in their road white jerseys with the orange numerals, the black trim, the orange helmets, metallic orange, and the white pants. And they will have, check and see who is the quarterback.
Now Wabash is going to start their first drive of the game here. Let's see how they can do.
Bryce Webster along with Devin Bendow making the tackle.
Now, Wabash had a pretty good return there, so we'll have to keep them from doing that more often.
Logan Vanderbilt and Austin Wheelan for the Apaches. As they face the second down and seven, now in Valley territory. Gets the back to pass. He looks for his tight end that time.
You know, that'll be a pass intended for number 40, who's not on this roster. So he's a mystery player there.
Wabash, as Rita, you mentioned, very impressive up front, strong up front, but only one senior up front, Matt Jones at the left tackle, Brandon Lutz at the other tackle. Seth Yaden and Brian Miller are the guards, and Trevor Pelfrey is the center for the Apaches.
Wabash definitely doing a spread-style offense. That'll be a flag on the play.
Looks to be on the offense, Jared.
Yep, that is an offensive false start. You know, and it's plays like that that have hurt Valley in the past, and it's great that they were able to keep their mindset on them and keep their heads in the game there. So that's hurt Valley so far this year.
Yeah, it was a good job by Valley there, not letting that player pull them off sides.
No, it'll be a deep pass by Wabash. Almost intercepted, but they're going to be able to get that super long pass there.
Not a good sight for Valley, but there's still a long game to go. And
that'll be number 80, Logan Vanderveld. Just a sophomore on that catch there. You know, but being 6'4", it's pretty easy to get a catch right there.
I would say that was pretty good coverage by number 43, nope, number 3, Cameron Parker, only being 5'8". Pretty impressive.
Oh, yeah, it's definitely hard to get a defender or to defend an offensive player that's got that much size on you. So, you know, he almost had it there and just got the ball plucked away at the last second.
Yeah. Mononucleosis is going to be out the rest of the year. Little jet sweep this time for the Apaches. The Valley will turn it in. Nice cutback, though, for Wabash. Very fortunate they kept Beecham down at the 9-yard line. Only a gain of two.
Beecham.
They'll bring up a third down and eight for the Valley 9-yard line.
Great job by Fields. Keep it outside arm and leg free. Turn that in to where the pursuit happened. And again, early in the season, that play would have went for a touchdown.
So Wabash now will have three receivers.
Wabash in the red zone, pushing for their first score of the night. Actually, the first score total of the night. That'll be another flag on the play. That'll be offsides on the Vikings. And you know, the quarterback, number 7, Sammy Hipskin, senior, he's got a mindset on him to push Wabash to achieve great things this year. Another flag on the play. Pass intended again for Logan Vanderveld.
They go right back to the 9-yard line.
Yeah,
I agree. It didn't happen before the play. Green Valley declined and bring it up a fourth down.
Here they're talking with the Vikings. So they're deciding whether or not they're going to accept this or not. That'll be an illegal procedure on Wabash. Vikings are going to decline that, bringing up fourth down. So. Wabash going for it here, looking for that big score instead of trying a field goal. And that was a great play by the Viking defenders. You know, just some key stats that Wabash definitely has some very key players and just overall more yardage than the Vikings. Number 7, Sammy Hipskin, is their leader for passing yards per game at 163.8. Now, that's a lot, especially when you compare that to Alec, who's at 76.6. Again, total yards per game, Sammy Hipskin above Alec, 171.4 to 99.4. Even rushing yards, number 34, Luke Proctor, is beating Deshaun Heckman. Valley trying to draw the Wabash defense offsides. That'll be the sophomore, Cameron Parker, on the carry.
That was a pretty good drive for him. I mean, he's only 5'8 and only weighs 155, so.
And you know, it's great to see a sophomore that's playing both sides and getting some good experience there.
That it is.
Valley will definitely need him for next year. And that'll be a fumbled pitch there, bringing Valley dangerously close to that goal line.
It's not looking very good for the Vikings so far.
Up front for Valley, the tackles on Michael Pasika and Amanda Winston, both seniors. Guards are Jonathan Daly and Dalton Webb, and the center is Hunter Hiding. Chris Seeker split wide to the right side. Dusenberry has checked in now. Parker, the lone running back.
You know, I can imagine a big pass here for the Vikings in order to get out from the goal line there. That'll be the throw to intended receiver number 13, Jared Dusenberry. He's a senior this year, and last year was his first year playing. And he's definitely shown that he has some clutch catching abilities. The leading scorer for Valley, actually, with 4 points per game.
First off, we'll see if they put a rush on. Duesenberger punt from just 2 yards from stepping out of the end zone, and Proctor will receive their punt at zone 40.
That'll be Jared Duesenberry on the punt here. Definitely evolving as a punter throughout this year.
What a great open field tackle by Bandow after a 38-yard punt and a 5-yard return.
That'll be a punt to number 34, Luke Proctor, a senior. And actually brought down by number 83, Devin Bandow, just a junior there, and he was quick there in order to make that open field tackle.
Yeah, he's a kamikaze. He's not afraid to hit. I've actually talked to some of the Valley football players, and they say he's none of them want to get hit by him because he hits like a truck for his size.
You know, he's not afraid to hold back there, which is great, just what Valley needs. That'll be a handoff to, again, number 34, Luke Proctor. Their leading rusher with 129.3 yards per game averaged.
Michael's been going to the dietitian. I think he's getting in much better shape. That's what you're
doing. He's working at it. Both ends. He's really working at the dietitian, trying to make that good, but also working.
Wabash on their second drive.
Second down and eight for the Apaches at the Valley 30-yard line. Again, a hard count. Honeycutt, hand off to Proctor.
Hand off again to Proctor.
Good stop by Valley there.
You know, I think we're seeing a new style of defense that we haven't seen from Valley at all this entire year.
Yeah, they've definitely new aggression level.
You know, those fundamentals are starting to get there. I think Valley was lacking that early on in the year.
That they were.
Devin Bandow, as we mentioned, is the safety. Heckman now in, as Wabash will go more wide on this third down and eight from the Valley 30-yard line. Halfway through this first quarter of play, no score between Wabash and Tevita Valley. Hipskin back to pass, looks to the right side. Now
Wabash looking for the pass, run not getting them too far. And that'll be an interception by number 83,
Devin Bandow.
And you know what? That's his second interception of the year, if I'm correct.
I think it is.
But again, I think the wind caught that. I think wind's played a lot more factor here, Mike.
Yeah, that's
again.
Wind is strong, but it's the windmill's
chirping.
You don't think that's
it's home field, man. It's big time.
First down and 10 for Tippecanoe Valley. Again, poor field position for the end, but they'll take it, holding Wabash out of the end zone early on.
Vikings giving a handoff to number 82, Genoa Melanimi, senior, who's been having some health problems this week so far.
Yeah, he got hurt in the Rochester game and got a sprain on his ankle.
You know, and it's really hard to fight back from an injury like that, especially this late in the season when your body's just tired there. So it's great to see him back out on both sides of the field here. Hand off again to number 82, Genoa Melanimi. You know, and that'll be senior Jared Duesenberry coming in off the sidelines.
Rowley and Trevor Pelkley are your inside linebackers. Valley now on first down and 10. They'll hand it off to Heckman. And no hold there for Heckman on first down. Second down and 10 for the Vikings. Outside linebackers are
Heckman,
Logan Vanderbilt, Tyler Houston, and Justin Beach.
Did the JV win last night?
Yeah. 27-16. That's a difference too, Mike. Remember, a year ago, Wabash really started 11 guys on defense and almost 11 different guys on offense. They've been unable to do that with the numbers this year.
They really like that. They just can't.
But again, 13-1 his first two games, and then he lost 31 games in a row.
spot.
But he certainly brought this Apache program back to
him. He definitely has more than 12.
No. DJ Heckman.
And that'll be number 12, Deshaun Heckman. Senior on the play, definitely able to show that he can move those legs and get the ball moving forward.
Great run there by DJ Heckman.
First down and 10 for Tippecanoe Valley. They move the ball out to their own 29-yard line. Clock runs with 3:50 to go in this first quarter. Play no score. Isaac Randall tried shifted and says, get back to the right side. Craig under center. Craig will hand it off. This time it's
that'll be a handoff to number 3, Cameron Parker. Again, that sophomore.
More often than not, if you scout Valley, Melanson in, more likely a run. Duesenberry in, more than likely a pass. Again, this day a huddle. I think the coaches can recognize that.
You shouldn't be
Greg, back to 12.
That'll be a pitch to number 12, Deshaun Heckman again. Heckman, the leading runner for Valley. Up to this game, averaging 60.1 rushing yards per game. And, you know, the beginning of the season, Valley was very pass-heavy, which kind of hurt Heckman on his running game. Later, though, with Coach Jeff Schreiber, Heckman's been averaging well over 100 yards per game.
That's really good for DJ. Being a talented player, as he is, he definitely needs his chances so he can get out there.
That'll be a handoff to number 3, Cameron Parker, breaking away long. Showing that he's willing to put in what it takes to get those long yardage.
And great reading those open pockets. He's definitely has moves for being a sophomore.
You know, you oftentimes don't see that in sophomores, do you, Chevy?
No, not very often.
First down and 10 for Tippecanoe Valley. Parker again, the lone running back. Melanson goes in motion. Craig back to pass. Roll down the right.
That'll be a quick little pass, number 15, Wes Melanson. Just not quite able to keep his hands on it. You know, Jeff Shriver there, just talking to him, telling him to kind of forget it. Don't let it get in your head. You just got to see the ball in and run with it.
Being a friend of Wes, that's one thing he struggles with when he's a very talented player, but he's very hard on himself.
You know, and that can either make or break a player.
That it can.
That'll be a handoff to number 12, Deshaun Heckman. Just not quite able to get anywhere. Wabash's defenders just stopping hard. They've been doing a good job of recognizing plays and just being there for all over the Vikings.
All you have to do is watch them and you can tell the difference. Of course, Tippecanoe Valley making huge differences on their staff, so we can get into that later.
So third down and 10 for the Vikings at the Wabash.
You know, you wonder if they're going to go for a pass here.
Third and long, I would assume so. Oh, but that'll be a run out to Deshaun Heckman. He's been able to get pretty far so far this season, just not quite able to do it.
Great sportsmanship there from Wabash.
You know, it's great to see things like that, especially after we just got done with the Rochester Valley game where I know tensions were tough there on the field.
Yes, they were.
Looks like the punt team's
looks like they're gonna
not going to be out here, and they're going to go for it. Alec Craig under center, number 5, senior. You know, just 4 seconds left on the play clock. And that'll be number 77, Evander Wimsatt, just having a hard time there, remembering the snap count. Here we'll see the punt team come out.
No, everybody has those mistakes, and they're not really meant, but just has to work on improving that and be better off.
Long punt by Jared. And that'll be number 34, Luke Proctor, pushed out of bounds finally on that reception. Wabash going to be taking over the ball. Worst field position so far in this game for the Apaches. That'll be a flag on the play. Looks like it'll be on the Apaches. That'll be holding on the Apaches. You know, that's a 10-yard penalty there from the site of the penalty, so things like that can really hurt a team.
Proctor showed a little bit of signs of what we saw last year, Michael, with a nice little couple of stops and moves.
He's pretty special.
Ipskin again, hands it off to Proctor on the right side. Proctor out across the 20-yard line. I look for a flag. Yeah, we're going to have a face mask. I think as Melanson reached out, he got Proctor's face mask. Gain a six on the play.
Yep, there's a flag on the play there. And that will be a face mask against the Vikings. You know, sometimes when you're going out for the tackle there, you just reach out and you cannot grab that facial area on the helmet.
Not always meant to, but.
No, I wouldn't say that was meant to at all. It's just, you know, he wanted that tackle and he just wasn't quite able to get it in front of the player there. That'll be another run by number 34, Proctor. And that'll be the end of the first quarter. We're going to take a quick break and we'll be right back.
And we're back.
You know, second quarter here, Vikings versus the Apaches. I'm Jared Michael here with Chevy Teeter. And that'll be a flag on the play.
Proctor again, Webster again. Maka, he looks like a natural inside linebacker. He
tell you, having Pasika and Baker dominating up like we are too.
You know, seeing these, seeing the Vikings defense is, they're very impressive tonight.
That they are. It's a whole new level of defense that we just haven't seen from them so far this year.
Patriotic pride standing for the national anthem?
They were that, but it was a little bit different source.
Or a first pitch in an hour and 45 minutes at Wrigley Field.
There
that
you go.
Could be it.
Coach Hammond's right here to my side. Loving the coverage.
Procedure of the call against the Apaches.
You know how loyal he is to Valley. He doesn't have a home shirt tonight. You know they're
second down and 14 for Wabash. The procedure penalty was called on the Apaches there.
Looks like that was an illegal procedure on the Apaches.
So second down and 14 for Wabash. It's Hipskin and Proctor in the backfield.
Trevor's getting
and Terry, the halftime, we get the PBG, right? They'll just go down by team by team and they'll march across there.
Hipskin. Waste the snap, hard count, trying to draw Valley outside. Proctor looking on.
Long pass by the Apaches. That'll be an overthrow.
You know, the Apaches going for those long passes like that, you're really going to get to see Valley's guarding ability on the receivers and see what Valley's defense is capable of.
You know, and I think they're able to go for those long passes like that, Chevy, because with those – they've got Proctor, who's a good runner and can generally get them close to a first down almost any time he gets the ball consecutively two or three times. So they can rely on him if need be and then go for the long passes.
That they can.
Penalty will be against Tippecanoe Valley. As again, they drew the Vikings off.
That'll be offsides on the Vikings.
I feel like there was a little bit of movement there by the Wabash, but
you know I saw the movement there too, Chevy. But it looks like Valley drew Wabash, so that's how it was on Valley. Quick pass out to number 85, Austin Wieland, Jr. Finally brought down by the duo of Bandow and Parker.
After that play,
let's have a good
one.
Find a little heat that time.
Yeah, very clean, but very good hit.
So again, this time Proctor will shift behind Hipskin on first down and 10. Hipskin,
and that'll be a fumble by the Batches, and it looks like Vikings have that ball.
Great play for the Vikings there, and Bryce Webster getting the ball there.
You know, Vikings definitely needing that. Still no score in this first half with 10:58 left to play in the second quarter.
I'm feeling this is going to be a very, very close game and great played by both teams.
You know, I agree with you, Chevy. I feel like this is going to be a very close game. Stats-wise, Wabash is ahead, but that's not factoring in that Vikings had a change in coaching and definitely a major turnaround since then. That'll be Deshaun Heckman on the carry.
And there's a flag on the play.
And that'll be holding on the Vikings.
Holding is the Vikings. And it will cost the Vikings 10 yards. And we'll
bring up a first down.
Daly really got to the edge, got his hands inside and was grabbing his feet. Really picture perfect position, so I don't believe it was on him.
Chris flipped on the left side. Melanson, Webster, Heckman also all to the near side. Cameron Parker is the fullback. Alec Craig under center. Craig ball. Hand it off to Heckman.
Hand off again to Heckman. Definitely relying on Deshaun heavily this drive.
Being second and long, you have to wonder, are they going to keep the run game up or are they going to go ahead and pass? I'm kind of feeling like they're going to pass because they're bringing Jared Dusenberry out.
You know, and we see that a lot with Valley, the interchange in between Dusenberry and Melanson. Whenever Dusenberry's out, normally it's more of a pass style, and when Melanson is in, it's a run style. Dump pass to number 15, Wes Melanson. Able to get it. Great play by the sophomore.
Chris Sinkers flipped by the right side. Still no score. 9:23 to go in the second quarter. Heckman goes in motion. Hand off in the middle to Melanie.
And that'll be a great run straight up the gut by number 82, Genoa Melanie, the senior. Definitely using that size to his advantage. You know, he's 5'9", 212, and most all of that is muscle, so it's great to see him being able to move even after the hurt ankle.
Now, I feel like this game we're not going to see Melanie out on the field so much, but when we do, we know we can say, hey, something's going to get done.
That's a name for all names.
Listen to this. Hand off to Heckman, or a pitch to DJ. And Deshaun, sometimes you see him listen to DJ, all the time
DJ
Deshaun,
Heckman,
he gets 3 and 48. The 35-yard line brings up a second down and 7.
Valley at 3
a week ago, we ran for over 135 yards. A big win against Rochester.
Second down, Dusenberry in on the field. And you know, you see the players wearing those pink socks. That is because it's the first weekend of October, and that means it's pink out night here at Death Valley.
The cheer block is definitely supporting the pink.
You know, it's all for Breast Cancer Awareness Month. That'll be number 5, Alec Craig, on that little out, rushing. Definitely showing that he can run. He's, as a quarterback, very Johnny Manziel-ish with how he can run. You know, a very versatile quarterback.
Very talented.
Webster, the tight end, to the far side. Heckman will now go in motion. Craig will roll out to the left side, looking for Sinkers, being pressured.
Oh, and Alec almost brought down there, but able to stay up. Pass to number 15, Wes Melanson. And that'll be a great catch by the sophomore. You know, it appears that those couple of mistakes early on in the game just haven't stayed in his head, which is something that he has a problem with.
Maybe the little pep talk from Coach Shriver really got really helped him out with that.
Vikings in the red zone for the first time of the night. Hand off to number 82, Genoa Melanimi.
Again, good positive yardage on first and goal.
driving forward and just chipping down that distance to the goal line.
We may just see the first score of the game here.
And you know, I think that'll be just what Vikings need, scoring first for this game. That'll be a pitch to number 12, Deshaun Heckman, but that'll be a flag on the play. And that'll be a block in the back against the Vikings. And that'll drop the Vikings back very far back.
That hurts.
That it does.
Seacrest lined up wide to the right, Dusenberry to the left. Craig under center. Craig rolls out to the right side, being pressured. Looking, steps into the front of the end zone.
And that'll be a pass intended for number 40, Bryce Webster Jr. So far, a key receiver for the Vikings. And the ball just goes above his head, just not quite ready for it.
Down inside the Valley 10-yard line before being turned away.
Vikings will turn them away with their defense, not with penalties.
So we'll see what
Vikings happens. Taking their time, getting up to the ball, third down. They have to make this count here. Lots of pressure on Alec. Pass to number 12, Deshaun Heckman. Brought down.
Looks for like a loss of a yard.
For about a loss of a yard, I would agree with that. And you know, that's a lot better than Alec running south there when we need the ball to go north.
Good ability scrambling there, but not a very smart idea running backwards.
Wabash has been pretty good tackling thus far in the game, even despite having quite a young defense.
Seacrest off to the right side. Dusenberry and Webster to the near side. Parker, the lone running back. Craig rolling out to the right side. Alec turning the corner.
Alec rolling out. Looking for that long pass to number 13, Jared Dusenberry. And like I said earlier, Jared definitely has those very clutch hands, able to get those passes, those receptions, when they matter. And there's that cannon that we all love to hear brought back. And Valley will have the first score of the evening.
That was a great effort there on fourth down.
You know, and it's plays like that that shows how Jared Dusenberry is the leading points per game for Valley. And that'll be a flag on the play.
And there's an offside against the Apaches there. You almost wonder if they move them up, are they going to go for two?
You know, that'll be half the distance to the goal there. Looks like they're still going to use the field goal here.
Noah Miller, the holder, waits the snap. High snap, brings it down. Santiago, a beautiful kick.
That'll be a kick by number 51, Domingo Santiago, and that kick is good. He's shown that he has a leg for those PATs. Just a freshman, I can see him maturing greatly in these next 4 years.
Very promising to see. You know, out of that PAT team there, you got to watch Noah Miller because he also plays some JV, and last JV game, they were getting ready to kick the PAT, and out of nowhere, Noah picked the ball up and ran it in, and it was very impressive.
It's great to have a versatile holder like Noah Miller who, if need be, can call fire and go in for the two-point conversion. That's 71, Jose Rivera on the kick. 34, Luke Proctor on the return.
A flag on the play.
You know, he's a senior and definitely Wabash's key runner. And that'll be holding on the Apaches. You know, and Proctor had a great return there, and penalties like that can really hurt him and take down your spirit.
That they can. Because some players that work their tails off, they are proud of the work they put in, and when things like that happen because of a mistake of another person, it can kind of upset them.
That'll be handoff again to Proctor. You can see he's a little bit shorter. Everybody is around him, only standing at 5'8", but he is 160, so it's a very solid size there. The Apaches, no one in the backfield. That'll be a pass to number 85, Austin Whelan, Jr.
And the tackle made by number 83, Devin Bandown again. Definitely great at tackling, great at wrapping up.
You know, Devin's just all over the field this game.
That he is. Being a safety, he's... Wow. And he and Proctor, first time they've been back in a couple of weeks. Valley's defense has been up to the challenge so far. Hipskin will hand it off to a jet sweep on the left side. And again,
that'll be a handoff to number 15, Eric Weber. You know, Weber is a senior and just stopped by number 40, Bryce Webster, Jr. There. Bryce definitely being a good attribute to the Viking defense so far this year.
And he hasn't really been in that inside linebacker position very much this year, but he's definitely very effective so far.
And that'll be a great sack by the Vikings.
With 3:40 to go here in the second quarter. Valley with a 7-0 advantage.
Valley really respects the front five of Wabash, so they're sending a lot of pressure from the outside.
And again, with the spread offense, this is something Valley was...
Wabash being able to be successful in the spread offense last time. Let's see how they do this time. Able to draw the Vikings offsides there. Vikings kind of having a problem with the ability to stay put. Three receivers to the right.
a huge blitz, and he had to open personal foul.
The only thing I can think is helmet, helmet, because he was at the ball at the second it was thrown.
Personal foul penalty.
Looks like that'll be a personal foul against Bryce Webster.
That, Jared, that one looked clean to me, but I'm not the ref, so.
First down and 10 for the Apaches at the 46-yard line, and Coach Schreiber continuing to let the referee know he didn't like it, and Coach McWhorter, I think he would like to see Webster out of the game after that play.
I just can't believe that was a penalty. Unbelievable.
So Hipskin and Proctor in the backfield. Two receivers left, two to the right. First down for Wabash. They have new life at the Valley 46-yard line. Hipskin.
You know, plays like that are just keeping Wabash alive. You know, you got to wonder, even though that play was considered a personal foul, that definitely shakes up a quarterback. That's been twice. He's been hit very hard. Well, three times now. He's been hit very hard in the backfield. And that really shakes you up over a game.
Yeah, earlier in the game, Wes Melanson had a great clean hit right as he was releasing the ball. Leveled him, and he was not having any of it.
You know, in that sack, that he definitely wants to get rid of that ball. He doesn't like that contact there.
Good job by Valley pressuring it.
That'll be a handoff to Proctor. Vikings so far this game definitely able to shut down the running offense of Wabash.
It's great to see this. How this Valley team has developed this year. You know, at the beginning of the year, we were just falling apart as a team.
Right now, we are definitely sticking together as a team, working together, so it's great. He's looking to pass. Long pass. Intended for number two, Justin Buchamp, 5'11". He's a senior, but, you know, it's hard to get an accurate pass there on the run. Number 40, Bryce Webster, definitely giving a lot of pressure, and I think he remembered what that last hit felt like.
Yeah. Bryce is a big boy, and he hits just like a big boy.
Punt team out for the Apaches.
Fourth down and eight. Apaches now have three guys on the right side. They will punt it to the right side. It will be a booming kick.
That'll be a deep punt. Rolls out the back of the end zone. You know, with 2:03 left to play here, I don't know. The Vikings are definitely looking to score here, but I'm not sure if they're going to be running a more super aggressive offense in order to try to get that score in this first half, or if they're going to try to play more of a safer run-heavy offense in order to run down the clock.
Yes, if they're looking to score, they either need a great blocking by the offensive line so the runners can get right up the middle, or they need to hit those key receivers.
Halftime. I'll tell you what's going on in other sports. Reed will have, and Michael both have stats and facts. We'll give you other scores. We'll have a conversation with Jeremy.
Yes, we will.
The legend.
My lip is just beginning to get the numbness from the jalapeno pepper I took on before.
Cleaned out your sinuses, though, didn't it?
It certainly did. It did that.
Craig, we'll hand it off.
Well, hand off to Deshaun Heckman, running up long,
getting the first down. Good job by Heckman there, getting out of bounds, stopping the clock. I know it's still early in the game, but to further themselves down the field, that was a smart move.
And you know, that wouldn't have been able if it wasn't for those key blocks that Heckman was able to get behind. Made it very easy for him to read the field and just go out there to out of bounds.
To Parker, and he's hauled down from behind. Strength along the wrist there as he's pulled down by Weber. Russell Wall of the program, a second down 11, and Ballon wants to take a timeout. We'll take one as well.
Looks like there'll be a timeout on the field. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back.
And we're back.
No lightning delay tonight.
44.
Second out of 10 for.
You know, beautiful night here for football. 109 left to play in the first half. Alec looking back for that pass, just shedding off that defender. Oh, that'll be a good pass to number 12, to Sean Heckman. But you know, that impact
just knocked it out of his hands.
And that was a great play by number 34, Luke Proctor, showing that he's not only good on the offensive side of the ball, but or on the field, but also on the defensive side of the field.
Clock stops with incompletion with 1:02 to go in the half. Now third down and 10 for Valiant. They're on 35. And it will be Craig again under center. Alec. Hands it off to Heckman.
That's a handoff to Deshaun. Looks like he's trying to make up for that pass there with his running ability.
That does look like.
Or at least make Wabash in a nine. You thought if it was going to be long, you might see a timeout by the Apaches, but if they take one, now we, you know, Valley would go for it. And now a timeout is Balboa. Timeout by the official as there's an injury for the Apaches.
That'll be
will check out for Wabash.
An official timeout.
It looks like Braxton Rowie had a little is injured there.
Either injured or a little equipment malfunction, something of that nature. You know, he's off on the sideline. He's pointing at a shoe, maybe his foot. So something along that lines. Doesn't look too bad, though. He appears to be in good condition, so that's great.
Looking for a long pass here from Valley. Only 3 seconds left. Got to get this.
And that'll be a penalty on the Vikings. 10 seconds left to play in this first half. Valley's definitely going to be looking for either a Hail Mary or just. Just going to knee it here, so. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back.
timeout to avoid.
And we're back. With 10 seconds here left on the second quarter.
First half.
We're hoping to either see. Well, wow. Valley is going to punt here.
And that'll be another timeout. We're going to take another quick break and we'll be right back.
And we're back.
And now Valley will bring the offense back out.
Valley bringing the offense back out after that break. They were.
Alec will do a little fake and he'll have go on the right side and have a first down.
Gives him a first down.
That'll be a really quick little drive there by Craig.
I think they wanted to see what Wabash was going to do with their punt return, too. Now they'll start the clock and. Each team will let the clock tick out. And
that'll be the end of the first half. Score 7-0. Vikings in the lead, so definitely good for them. Hello, I am Jared Michael here with Chevy Teeter on RTC Channel 4. And this is Valley versus the Apache. So far, score of 7-0, Vikings in the lead as we're starting our second half. Wabash having a great job with big plays, but just not quite able to make it in those average first downs. Valley definitely showing that they have the motivation to continue their winning streak that they are on so far.
That they are. They're definitely pulling together today. It's very impressive to see the defense and the offense.
It is great to see the Vikings working as a team in a way that they haven't worked as a team so far this entire year.
They're very outstanding tonight.
And they're about ready to start the second half here as the Vikings take the field. You know, and I'm really wondering to see who's going to come out with more motivation. Vikings were out on the field before the Apaches. So it'll be really curious here. Looks like the Vikings were lined up the wrong way, so.
It's going to be exciting to see the return because Valley hasn't got a chance to return so far this game other than a punt, but see if DJ Heckman can do what he's capable of here.
This, like Chevy said, this will be Wabash's first time kicking off for this game. And, you know, it's such a low-scoring game. I can really see this such low score continuing throughout this night. I really don't see any major breakaways happening.
Neither do I, Jared. Very even teams, but definitely a lot of hard work coming from the Vikings tonight.
Exactly, and they're both very defensive heavy. That's number 85, Austin Whelan, on the kick. Little kick. That'll be a pickup. By number 6, Isaac Randall. Vikings are starting their first drive of this new half.
Chris Seeker split wide to the left side. Valley will begin this drive.
That'll be a handoff to number three, Cameron Parker. And you know, he'll be stopped by number 54, Trevor Pelfrey, Jr. Quick pitch to Deshaun Heckman, definitely being a major runner for the Vikings, and he's just going to show that speed. He's got one man to beat, and that'll be a great touchdown for the Vikings. DJ showing that he is ready to continue on pounding that ball for the Vikings there.
And there was the cannon.
Vikings getting the first score of this half.
Now, seeing this excites me because Valley didn't draw Jimtown like they have in the last couple of years, and this year we've drawn West Noble, which
has about a season like we've been having so far.
That they have been playing South Bend teams, but maybe Valley will be able to push on to regionals this year.
And that'll be another good kick by number 51, Domingo Santiago, the freshman.
DJ really, his development over the last 3 or 4 weeks, it coincides with the development of the offensive line, of course, but really to watch him personally, just the explosiveness that he brings.
You know, it's great. Like I was saying, I wanted to see who would come out with the more motivation, and it appears that Valley is the team that came out with all cylinders running there, and they are ready to go in the second half.
You know, Wabash has had some good returns as Valley has kicked it off throughout the game, but after seeing that play, you would think it'd motivate the team enough. And a little bit of change up on the kicker here for Valley. They're bringing out Santiago instead of Jose Rivera.
You know, and this will be, I believe, the first time Domingo Santiago has kicked off for the Vikings.
Good kick by Santiago.
I think Randall making the tackle.
Such an aggressive, big, powerful.
50-50 winning ticket.
You know, and that just shows Vikings have been struggling a little bit with their kickoff. Definitely Wabash getting good yardage there.
Still on their own side of the field, but I could see that Valley might want to push them back a little bit more, like on the 20 or 25. Slot man with the near side.
Proctor, and Proctor's in the hole by Webster, and he throws him back after. Quick handoff. Bryce Webster showing that he is ready for that inside linebacker position, just shoving back anybody that comes up that gut.
Rita made a good point about bringing those players back. A lot of people thought, well, maybe Wabash will wait until the next game, but this really gives them an opportunity to get back in the same.
Yeah. Hipskin, and they drew a chop right. They drew Bremen in the first round of the play.
That'll be a quick right out pass.
Patchy's getting into Valley territory near the midfield inside the 48-yard line. Pass is cut that time by Corey Fuller. Fuller will have a first down
After a gain of 14 on the play, first down and 10 for Wabash at the Valley 48-yard line.
Great pass by the Apaches.
Wabash's first possession of the second half.
Hipskin up to 89 passing yards.
Again, this is a quick strike Apache team, especially with their starting quarterback back tonight. They're all playing into Proctor. Proctor, a couple of nice cuts. Jonathan Daly, a nice tackle, keeping Proctor in the first down.
Good work by the Valley defense to get that stop there.
Mm-hmm. And that just shows that Luke Proctor, the senior, definitely one of the major key parts of this Wabash offense.
9:40 to go here in the third quarter. A lot of football will be played, but Valley with a 2-touchdown lead. Hipskin under center. Or check down in the shotgun. Back at his own 46-yard line. Waits the snap. Again, drops back, looks deep. He's got a man out there.
And Bandow with the interception, the second of the game. Wow, Bandow is definitely a talented player.
You know, Devin is just in there ready to play. He is fired up, and I think that it's great that the Vikings can use him as a fire starter. They can morale or rally around Bandow, and it's awesome.
Yeah. The ball there was way ahead of him, and that dive. He's. Only being a junior. Wow.
And you know, he is not a big guy at only 5'6", 122, but he's able to throw that 122 around with all of his might.
Very determined player.
You know, and talking about younger players doing good this game. Number 3, Cameron Parker, just a sophomore, showing that he is ready to run the ball, taking over a lot for the senior, Janoa Melanimi, who got hurt last year against the Zebras, and the Vikings giving him a break every now and again. Cameron is swapping in very well.
Yeah, we're seeing the younger players' colors here.
And there we're showing Heckman again, just driving forward. If he can kick those burners in. Finally brought down by number 80 and 2, 80 Logan Vanderweld, sophomore, and 2, Justin Buchamp, the senior.
Wow, we are seeing a whole new Valley team here. They've had a good game so far, but this drive, wow.
I don't know what Shriver said to them on the sideline or what he said in the locker room, but it appears to have worked.
You know, you almost wonder if anybody from West Noble's watching, because I think that might be what they're trying to do. A little bit of intimidation there.
Maybe. It's great to see a new style of Vikings out here on the field. And if it works in that way, it's just an amazing way and awesome. Another pitch to number 12, Deshaun Heckman. Just showing after that, you know, he kind of flipped over the defender there. He could take a beating and keep going.
That he can. Now, you can see Janelle Melanimi is back. He hasn't played much, but when he has, he's made some decent-sized gains. So it's going to be interesting to see what he does here.
Again, handoff to Janoa. Just driving forward. Pretty big guy.
Solid muscle. The last couple plays, it's been six long.
You know, if the Vikings can score right here, that's going to be very detrimental to the Wabash Apaches' morale.
And it looks like. And there's another touchdown for the Valley Vikings. Great game.
And you know, DJ is just ready to play. That is his second touchdown of this game and of this half. Shriver, they were over on the sidelines saying that the Vikings need to get even more hyped than what they already are.
You know, I think Valley may have done a little bit of conditioning this week because the way they're moving, and it looks like they're wearing down the Wabash team.
You know, and that'll be another good kick by Santiago.
You're a legend. You ever seen a legendary turnaround?
Alive. It's alive.
And you know, Jared, I haven't said this very much, but I've heard word maybe Valley football, maybe it's back.
You know, it seems to be that way with how they're playing tonight. So far with their winning streak that they've got have been against teams that haven't won anything. Manchester and Rochester, which actually I believe are playing off tonight. But, you know, not really challenged there with their two wins. Wabash, however, is about as good as Valley so far with their record. 4-3 into this game, Valley 2-5. The Vikings looking to even it up here. Definitely showing that they are here in a new way that they haven't been before.
That they are. Great kick there from Santiago. You know, this is going to be one of the worst field positions that Wabash has had tonight.
You know, I think it might be the worst field position that Wabash has had tonight.
Now it's going to be interesting to see what Wabash does here. That last stretch by Valley there has to take a toll, but, you know, it could fire them up too, making them want to improve.
Exactly. They struggled in that area.
Yeah.
21-0, the Vikings, the 2 years ago. Quick handoff to number 34, Luke Proctor, senior. Definitely, they are relying on Proctor heavily the second half.
That they are. He's a very powerful in everything. Like, he's very powerful in everything he does with his runs and with his low interceptions.
Clock running this third quarter. Valley 21, Wabash 0. Hipskin in the pistol formation. Back at his own 20-yard line. Draw play goes to Proctor. Proctor makes a nice spin move. Gets across the 30-yard line.
And that'll be a flag on the play.
We'll see what that flag is. If it's a holding or a personal foul, it's thrown by the back judge. The play stands. It's a gain of 7 on the play. And it'd be a first down, but it looks like the penalty will be a call against Wabash. As Coach Shriver's already... talking.
That was certainly after the play, so I don't know.
Two flags. There's one at the 28 and one at the 33. It might be two. You know, remember that? We had those three flags on the field in that Manchester game.
Yeah. Hipskin's driving them back.
Yeah, moving them back.
And it looks the flag is on Wabash there.
Face mask is declined in the situation where they have to make something happen.
Okay, we had two flags. First was declined. It's just a 5-yard face mask penalty.
So that was a little face mask, was the first penalty against Wabash. And then a block to the back, which the Vikings will take, was the second against the Apaches.
Wants an explanation from where they marked the penalty from. Coach Trevor said, I would take the 5-yard penalty if that's what you're going to mark it from. Whereas it stands now, it'll be 2nd and 7 for Wabash at the 23-yard line. 5:51 to go in the third. Valley up 21-0. Quick out pass for the Apaches.
That's a quick little pass there. Little rough and tumble by number 51 and Bryce Webster. Wabash definitely seems to be targeting Bryce, it seems, with how they're going against him. Bryce is showing an aggression that Wabash just is definitely fighting against.
That they are. It's almost as, I wouldn't want to say, trying to scare Bryce a little bit, because Bryce isn't scared of anybody, and he's given a couple hits to the quarterback that they're not liking very much.
Deep throw. Cameron Parker, number three, was the nearest guy to that ball. Ball intended for number 15, Eric Weber, the senior.
You know, I feel like Cameron could have gotten that interception, but just wasn't looking and reading the pass, so wasn't quite ready for it.
Draw play goes to Proctor. Proctor hits the hole up near the 39-yard line.
And there's another flag on the play. You know, both sides are definitely having a hard time with the flags this game. That'll be unsportsmanlike conduct on the Apaches. Number three, Cameron Parker, just kind of getting shoved there after the play was over.
Yes, and seeing Janoa Melanimi just kind of stumble off the field there, his ankle must be bothering him again.
Trying to make sure they're in the right spot. Black runs with 4:40 to go here in the third, and now what do we got?
Official. Looks like that's going to be an official timeout.
He's going to discuss things with the umpires. They switched the down markers. Yeah, they let the play stand. That's what I thought was.
It was after the play.
Third down and 18. I didn't.
Just kind of making sure that it was the right down there on the field. Great coverage by number 15, Wes Melanson.
I'm so thrilled to be being able to watch this game tonight. Just the team pulling together, and it's amazing.
You know, especially when Wes was struggling early on in this game, and he has definitely come back from that on both the offensive and the defensive side. Wabash bringing out their punt team.
He's had some key catches in the game and key stops like that, so.
27 to go in the third. Valley up 21-0. Low snap there. Wabash's punter showing that he has quite the leg. That'll be a handoff to number 82, Janoa Melanimi. Flag on the play. This second half just riddled with yellow. And not the good kind of valley, but the bad flag kind. That'll be a block to the back against the Vikings. That'll be another handoff to number 82, Janelle Melanimi. Just not quite able to have the success that he was able to have on the last run.
It just looks as his ankle's hurting him a little bit. Like right now he's not showing it as much, but every once in a while you'll see him on the field and he'll be walking with a little bit of a limp. So
I definitely think it's with that endurance. You know, it'll take us a little hit there, and it bothers him a lot more than if it was all healed up.
Pitch play back to Heckman. Heckman eludes one guy, trying to use the swim move.
Heckman just not quite able to get out into open field.
Third and 15. Possibly, hopefully, Valley goes for a long pass here and is able to get the first down, keep the drive going.
You know, with that long pass theory, Valley's had some very successful runs, especially with Deshaun Heckman. So I can see him running out to that left side, that open side there, and hopefully maybe going for a first down that way too.
But yeah, also they've had some good passes.
Very good, very good passes. Alec Craig rolling out. There will be another flag. Finally tucking it and running forward to get that first down. However, that flag there might bring it back. And that'll be another block in the back against the Vikings.
So we'll see what happened there. And Craig was rolling to the right side, turned to the left. Daly Webb was trying to get the block, getting free.
I think that Coach McClure would be very happy if they tried to run some of those.
That'll bring up third and long.
California.
For the Vikings.
You know, you can see them bring Jared Dusenberry out, and I feel like you're just going to see a Hail Mary here.
I agree with you there, Chevy. Dusenberry's had some clutches. Normally, though, when he's not in the end zone, though, he's kind of struggled. So we'll see how this goes. Quick little screen to Bryce Webster, just not quite able to keep his hands on it. Bryce has been struggling so far this game, receiving, which we haven't really seen from him so far this year.
Yeah, normally he's very strong in his receiving. He's been struggling on offense this game, for sure. Defense, not so much. He's had a pretty good game defense.
I would say he's definitely made up for it defensively. You know, just everybody has their games. So that'll be Jared Dusenberry back to punt. Long punt for the Vikings. Again, that is the senior. Luke Proctor on that return.
Well, that was a pretty good opportunity to stop the running tackle enough to kick through that defense. And that job of stopping that right, it was a good return as it is, but it could have been a lot worse.
So. Tells you how dynamic Proctor is. That was a 20-yard return.
He's dynamic. Yes, he is.
So, hip skin and Proctor in the back.
So far, Wabash unable to score. 2:05 left to play in the third quarter. Again, that'll be another pitch to Proctor, 34.
Proctor has some speed to his ability to Valley being able to get that stop there. Good job with that, but that's not the run they wanted to let go.
No, I definitely think that Wabash is tired of being scoreless here, and they're ready to take it to Valley. I know their coach over there on the sideline has definitely been kind of getting after his players of, you know, get hyped up. That'll be a timeout for the Vikings. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back.
And we are back.
Valley definitely needs the stop here if they want to keep this game scoreless for Wabash. You know, I can really imagine a quick little rush to Proctor. And that'll be the touchdown for the Apaches.
You know, Valley isn't keeping the game scoreless, but they still doesn't take the fact away that they've had a great game. But great drive there from Apaches and just staying in the game.
Great drive. It started off with a great return by Proctor and then, you know, kind of stalled out there about midfield. And then Proctor had an amazing rush that brought him real close. And then he was able to kick it in there. So definitely give a little clap to Proctor.
Honestly, there, I think the only player that gained any yardage was Proctor on that whole run there.
Here will be the kicker, number 85, Austin Wieland. And it looks like the kick is good. Bringing up the score, 21-7. We're going to take a quick break as they're changing ground, and we'll be right back.
And we're back, getting ready to see the Apaches kick off to Vikings tonight. Score 21-7, Vikings ahead.
More common all the time.
You see it firsthand more than anybody,
yeah.
Like it.
Yeah.
85 the kicker.
Wabash on the scoreboard in the third quarter of play. Valley 21, Wabash 7.
High kick by the Apaches. Received by number 12, Deshaun Heckman, spinning around, kind of avoiding that contact, but
showing his agility there.
Just not quite able to get very far.
Well, Micah Valley's had some big runs of their own in the third quarter. Now let's see who wins the battle of the trenches right now here late in the third.
Yeah, Wabash is looking pretty fired up.
Craig under center on a first down and 10.
Three.
And off goes to Parker. Parker, nice spin.
Great.
Out across
great
the
spin there by Cameron Parker. Cameron Parker. The ambitious sophomore there.
You know, I think the word ambitious describes him perfectly in this game. You know, I would almost say with how he's running so far, if he might be going for that starting position over Melanimi, since Melanimi is injured.
That he is.
You know, Valley's been pulling together as a team, and part of that team is just good old friendly competition.
Yep.
Wabash's defense doing a great job stopping the Vikings.
Randall split wide on the right side. Dusenberry and Webster to the left. Heckman is the tailback. Craig under center. Pitch play goes to Heckman. Heckman, head in the hole and no gain there. What a big defensive stand by Wabash after 5 yards of Parker.
Apache's having a great, great stand against the Vikings. You know, I'm looking over into the Wabash Apache fans, and they've got two signs, the classic giant capital letter D and the little fence there. So Wabash definitely going for that. We're going to take a break as they take a timeout, and we'll be right back. And we're back. Fourth quarter starting here. Vikings versus Apaches at Death Valley. Beautiful night tonight. A little bit on the fall side, which is great. We haven't really seen that so far. So, number 13, Jerry Dusenberry on the punt. Low punt, not his best punt so far of this game. You know, with how good Wabash has been returning it so far this game, I don't know if that was so much of a bad move on Dusenberry's part.
That may have been the smarter thing to do, because they would have kicked it back far to Prochner. You don't know what he would have been able to do. Now, tonight is a great night for football. There's a little bit of a wind, and it's kind of chilly, but that's keeping the players from getting too hot. And
you know, we're not seeing near the cramping that we saw early on, and it could be partially because of the night tonight, or a lot of it, I think, is also the players are more conditioned as compared to earlier on in the season. Wabash definitely showing that they are not out of it yet.
As Prochner, very powerful in what he does. Just, he busts through two great tackles there, and luckily got stopped the last one, but
Vikings were able to shut down Prochner earlier on in this game, definitely first half, but Prochner has come out and shown a kind of new side as compared to the last half.
Yeah, I think his coach kind of might have had a little talk to him saying, you know, you're our lead runner, you're our lead scorer, so this is what you need to do. You need to,
you know, I think probably some dialogue like that did happen. As Chevy was saying, with lead scorer and lead runner, Prochner averaging 129.3 yards per game and 9.7 points per game.
You know, I haven't really kept track, but his numbers seem a little bit lower so far tonight.
Oh, yeah, very much lower. I haven't been keeping track of yards, but, you know, definitely not the scoring as compared to only having 7 on the night.
And that was Sammy Hipskin
quarterback, number 7.
Showing his versatility there.
Mm-hmm. We definitely see that from a lot from Alec Craig, number 5, for the Vikings. He's been having a little bit of a hard time so far this game. He's got very hurt ankles, so we haven't seen that, but it's great to see that other teams are using quarterbacks like that. And that'll be a flag on the play. Brought down by number 83, Devin Bandow.
Devin Bandow may be the only one that has really, really put a stop to Procter tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Against Valley, personal foul. It'll be first and goal for Wabash.
That'll be a personal foul against the Vikings. Bringing it up to the 4-yard line. So.
Now I really didn't see what happened there, but.
You know, I think that might have been a late hit. Refs have been making some very different calls that I haven't seen a whole lot this year, but they're doing their job. And that'll be the Apaches' second touchdown of this game.
You know, we really need to see Valley turn it up here because Wabash is proving that they're definitely still in this game.
Yep. If they can get this PAT here, that'll bring it to a one-score game. And the Vikings came out very fired up, and the Apaches are just firing it right back at them. 10:24 left to play. We got to see who's going to stay more pumped up. That fourth quarter is definitely one with whatever team has the most heart when it comes down to the wire like this. And it looks like the kick is no good. Looks like roughing the kicker on the Vikings.
You know, so far Valley's had a rough time with the penalties and everything that's been going on.
Very much so. First half of the game, very even on penalties. Vikings having a very hard time just staying together mentally for this game in the second half. Looks like Wabash is going to try again. And that looks like that'll be a stopped 2-point conversion. Score 21-13 now. No longer just a one score game. Wabash really needed that. We're going to take a break as they change around, and we'll be right back.
And we are back. Wabash getting ready to kick off with a little bit different setup by the Vikings here. They have Jaden Conley back deep, giving the freshman a chance to
show his colors here.
Mm-hmm. Jaden, so far earlier on this year, definitely showed some promise. If not a little bit of rustiness, being a freshman, little squib kick there. Valley fumbling it, but just hopping on it there. Like I was saying about Jaden earlier, he was having a hard time keeping a hold of the ball, but definitely doing a good job overall with returns.
And for his size, he's a very powerful player. As he progresses on throughout his next 3 years, he could be a force to be reckoned with.
Oh, I completely agree there, Chevy.
Craig under center. Craig pitches it back to Heckman. Heckman turns forward to near the 40-yard line.
That'll be a pitch out to number 12, Deshaun Heckman, the senior. Just stopped there. Wabash's defense doing a great job. Able to get a few yards, but just not what we've seen out of him so far in this game.
I feel like that little bit of a break that the offense had there, it kind of hurt Valley there.
You know, I think you're right. Craig rolling out, going back and forth, just dancing around defenders. Driving forward, showing that athleticism that he just possesses. Even with an injured ankle, hopping around, I don't know how many defenders I saw just lunge at him, grab a hold of his legs, and he just broke on through.
I think it was not one, not two, not three, but maybe four.
Yeah, in the backfield. I think you're right there, and he was just all around him. You know, it couldn't have been a plan, but I would say there was more defenders behind our line of scrimmage than what was in front of him there, and he only had to break past two defenders there in order to make the touchdown there. Valley's offensive line struggling right now, not giving Craig a whole lot of protection.
They were doing better earlier in the game, and maybe it's just a little miscommunication and they can fix it up.
You know, we've noticed as this year went on and with previous seasons, Valley's had a lot of amazing plays with kind of the backyard football style of offensive, you know, very mistaken play, and Alec Craig being able to break long there. Hand off to number 12, Deshaun Heckman. Just not gaining what we've seen from him so far in this game.
The whole Valley offense has slowed down a little bit that I've noticed. Other than the outstanding run of Alec Craig there.
You know, the Vikings definitely need a score here in order to stay ahead of the Wabash Apaches.
And they're going to bring out the punt team.
You know, Wabash has been doing a great job in previous drives of scoring here. Vikings just not quite able to bring it like they were earlier on. Long kick. Definitely good accuracy by Jared. I would say that he's been practicing punts a lot compared to how he's progressed over the year. You know, this is an edgier seat type game, 21-13. Barely any time left to play in this fourth quarter.
Ben Shriver and Jared Littlejohn, two former Viking players of recent years, about row 12, about 50-yard line going. Can we get out there right now and let the defend?
Viking legends.
First down and 10. 34. Ben will hand it off to Proctor. Proctor falls for it near the 24.
You know, they are not shying away from using Luke Proctor. I'm really wondering if he's going to be getting tired or not because of how much they've been using him.
You know, the way this game is going, it kind of reminds me of a boxing match. One team will give it their all and wear themselves out, and then the next will fight back until they're worn out.
Mm-hmm, and I'm wondering if it's going to end up like one of those boxing matches where it seems like it's going to be a tie up till the end, and it ends up going to just the final couple seconds that decides it.
Wabash looks at their wristbands. Hip skin and the pistol. Proctor behind it. Two receivers to the left, one to the right. Hip skin,
handing out to Proctor, that nice little pitch there. And that'll be number 83, Devin Bandow, showing that he is ready to hit like he is just out there. I mean, he's ready to play in this game tonight.
You know, looking at it, Proctor looks a little bit confused.
You know, Bandow only weighing 122 pounds. It's baffling to me how he's able to make plays like that.
His speed, I feel, is a big contributor to that. He gets going so fast and just isn't scared to, he doesn't let back. He just gives it all.
No, he doesn't. And a lot of players just right before they make the contact. And that'll be a flag. Valley drawn offsides there, looks like. Nope, that'll be illegal procedure against Apaches. I'm sorry. They're the ones who jumped first, and so that'll be 5 yards against them.
And it looks like they're going to give Devin Bandow a little bit of a break and maybe take him to the sideline and congratulate him on that.
He has definitely earned it.
Two receivers on the right side, one to the left for the Apaches. Pass Proctor to the right this time. Hipskin awaits the snap. Draw play to Proctor. Proctor makes a nice move. Oh, gets across the 30 to 31, as you said, Mike. He almost dropped the three.
Valley definitely working on shutting down Proctor again. It's a good thing to say, but they just got to keep it up.
Mm-hmm. I completely agree, Chevy.
Proctor
in the backfield.
Yeah, we got close to the line.
Look at him standing out on the field, and we'd get a flag for that.
Nope. Hipskin throws it out. Looking, makes a spin move that time. It's Vanderbeek out near midfield in the Valley territory at the 1 yard line.
Vanderbeek.
So
19
to the 50.
Sophomore with great size.
That official is standing there.
If we did that, we'd be out. 21, Wabash 13, down to 5:20 to go here in the fourth. Proctor behind Hipskin. Hipskin, draw play again. No, Hipskin will keep it himself.
Oh, that was a little smoke and subtlety there by the Apaches. Hipskin trying to keep it, and then passing it on.
So now Wabash again. Clock stopped with 5:11 to go here in the fourth.
Come on, Dre, do something.
Man up front trying to be the lead blocker for Proctor. Now they'll do the draw play.
Great stop there by Valley, stopping Proctor, and maybe a loss of one.
Valley by a 21-13 advantage.
And the clock keeps ticking.
Not bad. So Wabash this time Still trying to decide where they want people.
You know what? Ball's actually
Coach McMurk.
Yeah, it's
looking
still
at his big play sheet.
Yeah, until it crosses
give it to him. Play clock down to 5. Down to 4. Now they finally get set, and Coach McGuirt says, I want to take a timeout. We'll take one as well.
Timeout.
Down to 4:28 to go on the floor.
And they're taking a timeout, so we're going to take a break and be right back. And we're back. 4:28 left to play. Wabash looking for a score here, trying to tie it up. And almost intercepted. Intercepted by the Vikings there. That is an amazing
freshman
catch.
Tanner Trapedi there.
It's on to, up to discussion right here, right now.
DJ Heckman says Tanner, the freshman, came up with it.
Yeah, there's not much doubt. No replay.
Wow. Yeah, again, there's no 100-foot video replay. We're not at Jerry's World.
Yeah, this is a good time, though. It'd be nice to have an instant replay option.
Oh, yeah.
Looks like they're not going to count that as an interception for the Vikings. So that'll just go up as a broken pass for the freshman, Terrence Petey. Bringing up fourth down.
So now fourth down, 11 for Wabash at the 49 with 4:19 to go. Looks like the Apaches will go for it here.
You know, I feel like Coach Trevor there is very upset with the ref's calls there.
You
know, hopefully the Vikings can use this as a little motivator here. And that'll be deflected up by Bryce Webster, giving the Vikings excellent field position there.
Well, Valley didn't hang their heads after it looked like Tanner Trapedi had an interception, and out of that, Valley actually gains about 30 yards in field position with 4:15 and maintains a 21-13 advantage.
All right. Webster, what a play. Heads up. And my coach said he's had an hour of practice in that position, and he looks like a natural.
Yeah, guy that shifted from a defensive end position. And then wasn't able to play really because of that leg injury as a freshman.
Yeah, just basically had about a day or day and a half of coaching up for that position. That's all he had.
First down and 10 for Tippecanoe Valley.
Huge drive.
4:15 to go with the fourth. Wabash down to 2 timeouts left. And on goes to Parker, and Parker hit in the hole.
Why are we
and
running?
No! But those rule that forward possession have been stopped.
And it looks like they're going to rule that as forward possession, so play down.
Why do we run the same play every
so
time?
Second down and 9 for Valley.
No gain.
Dang it.
Clock continues to run with 3:55 to go.
The same play that Heckman had quite a few yards on.
I feel like Valley's just going to try to run down the clock here as keep this as a long possession.
Definitely they're going to try to use up the clock here and get a score. You know, if they can get a score here, that with using up a lot of the time, that'll definitely put the nails on the coffin. And that'll be Deshaun Heckman just kind of losing his grip there. Not able, having a great cut, but just the ground giving away, so not able to get very many yards.
And you wonder with it getting a little bit chillier if there's a little bit of dew sitting up on the field.
They're going to call a timeout. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back. Whatever happens, happens from here on out for the Vikings. They get to control the clock here. Craig driving forward, getting that first down, which they need.
Just what they needed. Keeping this possession, just gaining yards and running down that clock.
I was going to say there, Chevy, once the chain gang gets set up, that clock will resume. And just eating away that time, which Wabash so desperately needs.
Wabash 13 and the Vikings. First down and 10. They don't have to. Now the play clock down to 5. Craig under center. Play clock at 3, and Valley will be forced to take a timeout.
Looks like Valley's going to take a timeout, and we're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back.
And we're back from the break.
You know, 2:45 left to play here. Vikings still looking to drive the clock down. Wabash out of timeouts. And that'll be a great handoff to DJ Heckman, just driving forward.
Just short of a first down, it looks like, but
that'll keep the clock moving.
What a run by Craig Picard, the previous on a third down and 9, just kind of a naked bootleg.
Craig's got the heart of an elite Viking warrior. They used to be known as berserkers, and he will not be denied.
Yeah, I can find a people that's based on what a berserker
what is.
What
is a berserker? It's an elite Viking warrior.
Viking warrior.
And off to Melanemi, and Melanemi will fall forward. Might have a measurement here.
No,
maybe the 30. And if it is the 30, that should be.
Looks like that'll be very close there.
You know, Valley's Deshaun Heckman, if I heard right, he's had a great game with 174 yards rushing this game.
I know, and that's, well, he just keeps adding on each game. Last game was around 160 yards a game, and against Manchester, just a little over 100 yards in that game. So he just keeps adding that on, so it's great to see that. Chain gang coming out, and it looks like that's
just an inch away.
Just inches there.
Mr. Hammond says, I don't know if it's in or out in tennis. And Chris Kindig said, I'd be off the bench wanting an explanation. And Coach Shire says, I got a pickle in your pocket.
Very careful.
And play will resume.
Clock runs with 1:45. The Vikings looking for the third win in a row, up 21-13 here late. Craig under center. Melanie and Heckman in the backfield. Pitch play to Heckman. On the left.
Pitch to Deshaun, getting that first down that was needed.
Ball security, if it wasn't the name of the game earlier, Rita, it is now.
Oh, absolutely. Time to score.
They don't have to get a first down. That's why I said ball security. Valley wants to take a timeout.
They're going to call a timeout. We're going to take a quick break, and we'll be right back. Jeff Shriver jumping up and down on the sidelines, trying to pump up both the crowd and the players. And that'll be a knee. And it looks like this is going to be the game here. And it looks like after Valley's just going to keep taking knees here. This has been a great game. Some impact players for the Apaches. Number 7, Sammy Hipskin, the quarterback, definitely showing that he has an ability to run and pass. And definitely number 34, Luke Proctor, majorly pushing as a running back and as a returner, doing an amazing job. Also on defense, being able to stop. For the Vikings, number 12, Deshaun Heckman with great runs, over 174 yards rushing. Wes Melanson doing some great stops and some great passes. And lastly, number 83, Devin Bandow just being a monster on the defensive side with two, almost three interceptions.
Having a great game, Jared.
That'll be the Vikings' third consecutive win, Wabash's fourth consecutive loss. Vikings looking definitely down the season to do great once they get into sectionals. Again, I'm Jared Michael with Chevy Teeter. Thanks for watching Tippecanoe Valley Football on RTC, and check out www.rtc4.com for more videos.